Bermuda Broadcasting streams the news live on Facebook. Go to Facebook and look up ZBM News 9 and press the like button. You'll get notifications just before the news starts each night. And all of our newscasts are stored there so you can watch them 24/7 at your convenience. Bermuda Broadcasting wants to make it easy for you to stay up to date with your local news. So please sign up to watch us on Facebook Live 24/7 for up-to-date news from Bermuda Broadcasting. You can
count on us. Fresh Purdue Value Pack chicken thighs with drumsticks, only $1.99 per pound. All varieties of potatoes, just $4.99 for a 5-pound bag. Dole pineapple slices for your Christmas ham, only $1.89 for a 20-ounce tin. For your mac and cheese, Cotelli macaroni, just $1.89 for a 500-gram box. Tropicana premium orange juice, only $5.49 for a 59-ounce bottle. Visit our website at www.marketplace.pm for more weekly specials.
Live from Bermuda Broadcasting, this is ZBM TV 9 News.
Well, good evening, everyone. It's Tuesday, December the 5th, 2017. I'm Diane Brewer, and thank you for joining us tonight. Bermuda has not been included in a European Union blacklist of tax havens. The government has said the decision demonstrates the island's position as a global leader in international tax transparency. But Bermuda is on a second so-called gray list, countries that are seen as not complying with EU standards but have committed to change their tax rules. Hal Davis reports.
EU finance ministers meeting in Brussels today finally came to an agreement on the countries be placed on the blacklist. 17 nations are on it, including Caribbean states like Barbados, Grenada, and Trinidad and Tobago, but not Bermuda. That's been welcomed by the government. A statement by the Premier, David Burt, released today, says the decision recognizes Bermuda's status as a cooperative jurisdiction and demonstrates Bermuda's position as a global leader in international transparency. But Bermuda is on a second list, the grey list. That's for countries which don't currently comply with EU regulations but have agreed to change their tax laws by the end of 2018. The EU's main complaint against Bermuda doesn't seem to be about transparency, but about the island's 0% corporate tax rate, with some European governments worried businesses may use that to shield their profits from EU states with higher taxes. And it's clear that being on the grey list, along with 46 other nations, won't protect Bermuda from being blacklisted if it doesn't take action.
But there is a list of more than 40 jurisdictions which have taken a number of commitments with which they need to comply in order to ensure that they are eventually not put on the list of non-cooperative tax jurisdictions.
It's unclear what impact possible sanctions would have on Bermuda. The EU says that implicated jurisdictions would have European funds cut off, but the island doesn't receive any. A tax on capital flows has been suggested, but that's highly unlikely anytime soon. What is clear is that the EU listings have already been heavily criticised. The charity Oxfam protesting outside the EU headquarters today. It's calling for stronger measures against tax evasion and points out, by the EU's own criteria, 4 member states should be on the blacklist. Other charities say the list is politically led, as it includes only nations that are economically weak and unconnected. As a British territory, Bermuda is not in that position, but with Brexit looming, that may not be true for very much longer.
In other news, former One Bermuda Alliance leader Craig Cannonier reiterating the need for change from within, even if it means removing some of the old guard. Speaking with Gary Moreno following the last sitting of the House of Assembly, Mr. Cannonier in calling for the former members of the now-defunct United Bermuda Party who remain members of the One Bermuda Alliance to call it a day.
I think that was always the plan. My role in getting involved in forming the One Bermuda Alliance was not to form the United Bermuda Party. We felt that there were many people out there who were willing and wanted to come into the arena as new members of Parliament, as new individuals interested in the politics of the country going forward. I don't think it goes without saying that there are several members within the OBA who feel very strongly. You've seen it in the public and Facebook that feel that there are some members who now need to move on. It becomes a very balancing act, doesn't it? You've got experience as well as new members coming in. And I think that any party that is worth its salt and savor needs to move new people into its organization. I'm not saying anything at all right now. What I do believe is that as the OBA continues to look at how it revamps itself, there was a clear statement that was made back in July. We now need to go over what that statement is, assess where we are as a party, and then make the decisions that are needed going forward. Certainly, I put my name in the hat because I felt that certain things needed to happen. I was not successful, so we'll see what the new leader brings about. But again, those are internal issues that the party needs to deal with, and we'll leave it internal. The One Bermuda Alliance is an amalgamation of people. All you got to do is look at the party. It's several different people coming together as we move forward. To distinct whether or not we got one of this and one of the other, you know, we're starting to get into...
Well, it's clear to see. The party mm-hmm. does not have the same makeup as it had before, mm-hmm. clearly because of the outcome of the election mm-hmm. and so on. But mm-hmm. many of the former members have, for want of a better term, jumped ship, not necessarily to the opposition, but they're no longer part of the OBA.
Well, I think those members are looking for change. That's what they're saying. And they're looking for that change to happen as soon as possible. That's the message to take from that, that they understand what's needed. They feel that they know how we should be going forward, and they're making their statements very clear to us.
In other news, Russian athletes will only be allowed to participate at the Winter Olympics Games under a neutral flag. The International Olympic Committee have announced following the publication of their Schmidt report into Russian doping. Earl Basin has more in this report with a member of the Athletes Commission.
The International Olympic Committee today banned Russia from participating in the Winter Olympic Games. Patrick Singleton, who is a member of the IOC Athletes Commission, was asked about today's decision.
It's a very good decision. I just spoke to Angela, our chair of the IOC Athlete Commission. She's on the executive board, who took the decision. It was based off of the Schmidt and Oswald Commission reports that were released today. It was a long time coming. They've been looking at this for 18 months now. You know, WADA has come out with their own reports, and we actually told the Deputy Prime Minister last week that they weren't coming back in, at least according to WADA. The IOC has come out and defended the integrity of sport. It sends a very good message. The Russian NOC will not be accredited for the Pyeongchang Olympic Games. Their Deputy Prime Minister will not be accredited. No officials from the Russian Ministry of Sport will be accredited. And Russian athletes will have to march and compete under a neutral flag, the Olympic flag. The Olympic anthem will be played, not the Russian anthem. And they need to clean up their act. And they have got to adhere to certain guidelines, both from WADA and from the IOC. They have got to pay us about $15 million to set up an independent agency. They've got to do a whole lot of things before they can come back into the Olympic movement. And I think today's message sends a very clear message to Mr. Putin and to his ministry of sport that we're not going to tolerate this kind of interference in the Olympic movement.
Let the Marketplace help you pull together any party or any special occasion. The Marketplace food court offers all kinds of dishes, dinners, and sushi made to order. Choose from a variety of party platters, whether it's chicken wings or shrimp, classic meat and cheese, fruit and vegetables. Between the Marketplace food court and the Marketplace bakeries, we have everything you need and more. Let the Marketplace be your kitchen away from home. Visit us 7 days a week for quality service and prices you can count on.
When you shop online, the cheapest, quickest, and easiest way to bring your packages into Bermuda is with U.S. Express at mailboxes.
And there are things that you can't ship to Bermuda sometimes, especially IT equipment and things like that. It's just easy to put in a U.S. address, and it just gets there every time. They notify me immediately when the packages show up. If they need an invoice, I send it to them. But when I show up here, it's ready to go.
Sign up for a U.S. Express account at www.mailboxesunlimited.com today.
Your home, your life, security. Be fire and burglar free. Right from your phone, monitor control. Lock safes, doors, case, business, family safe. You're on the go, and that's okay. BSG with you every
Bermuda day. Security Group, your security, life safety, and monitoring experts. We're with you every step of the way. Bermuda Security Group, BSG.BM.
Welcome back. A spokesperson for the Board of Education tonight saying the Bermuda Union of Teachers representatives and members of the executive have been fully involved in the development of this strategic plan from start to finish. This following claims from Mike Charles, General Secretary of the BUT, that he did not recall the plan being discussed with the union. The spokesperson says BUT representatives provided input into the development of the prototype and also during the entire process of developing the plan. The BUT was provided with the drafts of the various plan prototypes by email as they were being developed. These emails were sent directly to the President and General Secretary with the intent of informing the BUT of the progress being made in the development of the plan as well as eliciting their feedback. The Bermuda Union of Teachers has two representatives on the Board of Education. During the development of Plan 2022, these individuals were Tamisha Darrell and Jason Wade. Mrs. Darrell chaired the work stream on data collection during the community conversations phase of the plan's development, while Mr. Wade led the work stream on organizing the community conversations. A number of teachers participated in the development of the plan as members of the Ambassador Design Team. Some members included, among others, Renee Heiler, Pat Nesbitt, Leon Charles. These teachers attended both evening and weekend work sessions. On Thursday, November 16th, the Board of Education passed a unanimous resolution to submit Plan 2022 to the Minister of Education. The BUT representatives on the Board of Education participated in that vote, end quote. Once again, coming from a spokesperson for the Board of Education. In other news, concerns of a Bitcoin bubble as government considers venturing into cryptocurrency, not the focus of National Security Minister Wayne Keynes, under whose portfolio the initiative falls. This as he asserts government is not interested in the Bitcoin aspect of the technology. Gary Moreno tells us more.
You've probably seen the ads on Facebook and other social media platforms. If you bought $100 of Bitcoin 7 years ago, you could be a millionaire today. Or even seen the latest news last week that Bitcoin was up significantly on the stock market. However, some jurisdictions are now looking at implementing more stringent regulation as it pertains to the new form of currency or commodity, depending on how it's viewed. That, however, is not where the Bermuda government is focused.
We're looking at Bermuda evolving into the blockchain. And so, whilst this sounds like Greek to a number of our listeners, we believe that what we're trying to do in Bermuda is we're trying to set up an ecosystem that allows our technology to flourish, whether it's medtech, whether it's insurance tech, whether it's edutech. We believe that Bermuda could be the center for a number of things related to technology. A good place to start is in using blockchain technology, looking at utility tokens starting out.
The minister affirming, though, that does not mean it'll be a free-for-all.
We believe that this is an opportunity, first of all, to put some experts in place. We have a legal and regulatory committee, and that committee is looking at this from a legal and regulatory position. We have people from NAMLAC, we have people from leading law firms, we have people from the government, the Register of Companies, and the like. So when people start initially saying how dangerous it is, well, let's give each other credit that we're going to put the necessary regulations in place.
According to Minister Keynes, this is where the Business Development Committee, headed up by John Narroway, comes in.
What they're going to be doing is looking at businesses coming into Bermuda. As you can be well aware, there are a number of elements of this that we believe, and it's clear, that are not safe. But we have full confidence in creating a self-regulatory body with a light touch when it comes to regulation, looking at it, putting together a clear legislative framework. We believe that will serve as a sieve to get out some of the more nefarious players, people that are unscrupulous.
Mr. Keynes admitting, though, the concern being expressed does not come as a surprise to him, since the very same situation existed when Bermuda was considering venturing into another industry several years ago.
I was talking to one of our senior statesmen, and he said there was that significant set of disquiet when the reinsurance industry was set up in Bermuda. And as you know, we are a leading jurisdiction in reinsurance.
Gary Moreno, reporting for the Bermuda Broadcasting News.
In other news, government has agreed to a 2.5% pay rise for the Bermuda Fire and Rescue Service under a new collective bargaining agreement. Pleased with today's successful outcome, Minister for Government Reform Levita Fogo said of the BRFS, "We are proud of their role in our community and we are thankful for their bravery and courage." Chief Fire Officer Lloyd Burchell also commenting, quote, "It's my view that the signing of this collective agreement represents a step in the right direction towards improving officer morale and helping to clarify the future of the fire service. Just last month, you'll recall, the minister announced the completion of negotiations with the BPSU, which also led to a 2.5% pay increase. Turning to weather news, another gorgeous day in store for our Wednesday. Here's the latest from AccuWeather headquarters.
AccuWeather is presented by BF&M Insurance Group. We now go to AccuWeather headquarters.
The BF&M Insurance Group is pleased to bring you tonight's AccuWeather forecast. I'm your AccuWeather meteorologist, Daji Aswad. Here's a look at our current condition. We do have a few clouds out there, and we do have a low to the north of us, and that's spinning counterclockwise, and that's going to influence some of our ocean conditions here. So we can expect some advisories out for tonight into tomorrow. Outside of that, we have our next frontal system on the way. That's going to push its way into Bermuda, and we can see some rain in our extended forecast. Here's another look at all those systems. This is our water vapor, and this is basically displaying how much moisture we have out there. The yellow shows dry air. So we're a little bit dry air, but we are having some moisture peek in from the west, and as that continues to push its way in here, we'll see an uptick in cloud cover as we head into your extended forecast. Here's a look at your current conditions. Temperatures across the islands in the upper 60s, humidity 64, winds out of the northeast 10 to 15 knots, and our water temperature sitting at 73 degrees, waves in the reef 2 to 3, waves out 7 to 11. So we definitely have some high waves out there, and we do have a small craft use caution out, so please keep that in mind. Tonight, we're going to see partly cloudy conditions, low of 63 degrees as we take you to tomorrow's forecast, high of 70 with a low of 66. Periods of clouds and sun are expected throughout the day, so overall a nice day, and we're not too worried about any wet weather at that point in time. Here's another look at some marine conditions. Your next high tide is expected tonight at 9:49 p.m., and then our second high tide at 10:17 a.m. tomorrow. And once again, we will probably still have some high swells out there, so keep that in mind. If you're getting away, here's a look at some other locations. Toronto, 37 degrees, mostly cloudy conditions. New York, 47 with mostly cloudy as well. As you head to Atlanta, some rain is expected there, topping off at 51. And as for Miami, 85 with mostly cloudy skies. Here's a look across the Caribbean. Right now, current conditions for Jamaica, we're looking at a high of 92 degrees, cooling down to 75, and we'll see some mostly cloudy conditions out there, passing shower to the southern portion of the island. As for Barbados, Trinidad, we have a lot of moisture out there, so showers are likely across Trinidad and Barbados tonight. Here's a look at your extended forecast. Wednesday, not too worried about rain, but that frontal system that we talked about will begin to inch its way in here Thursday, and that's going to bring some showers into our area. It's not going to be a complete washout, but it will. We will see the uptick in clouds and showers. Then as we head into your Friday, that front stalls out. It doesn't quite make it here yet. Still looking at pretty nice days for your Friday as well as Saturday. Mostly sunny conditions, a high of 76 degrees, and we are seeing our temperatures warm up into the mid-70s because we're seeing a southwesterly flow, and that's really going to help us remain in the mid-70s. But then as we get our frontal system in, the sun goes away, and then we see some rain for your Sunday, so be sure to be prepared for that. If you have any outdoor plans, make them indoor plans, because that frontal system will be bringing some rain and showers to the area. And if you have any news concerns or updates about the weather, please feel free to contact me on Twitter. Outside of that, be sure to stay tuned to Ocean 89, Power 95, and Inspire 105 for all your latest news and updates.
AccuWeather was presented by BF&M Insurance Group.
Santa suits
and party hats,
letters sent,
gifts neatly wrapped.
It must be Christmas. Let the magic begin.
Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
Colonial, where people come first.
Christmas in Bermuda is a special time for most of us. Unfortunately, for some families in Bermuda, there is no warm Christmas. This year, many families will be in need. It's the 29th anniversary of the Lions Clubs of Bermuda and the Marketplace helping share the Christmas spirit, so let's help take care of each other. Shop at any Marketplace, Shopping Center, Modern Mart, or A1 stores and purchase extra tins and non-perishable items. Once you have purchased these items, place your food donations into Santa's bin located at the front of the store. The Lions Clubs will collect your food contributions and assemble them into hampers to be delivered to the families in need around the island. Christmas comes once a year. Help make it a special time for every family in Bermuda. Sponsored in part by the Bermuda Broadcasting Company and the Royal Gazette.
Now here's Earl Basden with tonight's sports report.
CONCACAF and FIFA referee instructors Victor Stewart and Rohan Thorburn from Jamaica are on island assisting the improvement of referees in Bermuda. Stewart, when asked about his second look at the officials on the island, stated,
"Well, if you look at it incrementally, the appointment of Tashan to the FIFA list is one achievement that would have occurred, albeit it's not just this year that he started. He would have started before, but it finally culminated in this year. He being nominated this year. So there are some improvements. There are still a far way to go in terms of the number. And another sore point is the age grouping of the referees we have here. But I'm willing to work in tandem with the FA in order to assist in that regard."
Right.
Tonight's sports is brought to you by the all-new Boundary at Fairmont Southampton, the West End's only sports bar. Catch all the action and enjoy smoked perfection barbecue, beer, and other pub favorites. It's game on at Boundary.
Kaya Lewis was named the St. Johnsbury Academy 2017 Girls Soccer Player of the Year. After winning the award, Lewis is quoted as saying, "It's an honor since I'm not the best soccer player. I try to put a lot of work into it so I don't let my teammates down. It's nice for my efforts to be recognized." End quote. Meanwhile, Bermuda Broadcasting Sports can confirm that Lionel Cann was last night elected as the new president of the Bermuda Referees Association. Cann replaces Anthony Bailey, who was elected as the association's treasurer, while Cassandra Trott was elected as the vice president, and Wendy Woodley remains the association's secretary. Youngsters Mateo Donowa and Tashan Simons are also elected as executive committee members. Bermuda Football Association confirmed the 2017-18 Shield and Friendship quarterfinal draws and venues. On Sunday, December 17th, four doubleheaders will take place. BAA, PHC Stadium, Bernard Park, and the Devonshire Recreation Club will all host a Shield and a Friendship quarterfinal match. The Shield quarterfinals will get underway at noon with Southampton Rangers and Somerset Eagles going to battle at PHC Stadium, while Ireland Rangers will travel to BAA. Devonshire Colts and Paget Lions will battle at Bernard Park, with Wolves and entertaining St. George's Colts at the Devonshire Recreation Club. The Friendship quarterfinal matches will get underway at 2:30, where the PHC Zebras will entertain the Somerset Trojans at the PHC Stadium, Devonshire Cougars will entertain Flanagan's Onions at the Devonshire Recreation Club, or Robin Hood are at home at the BAA Field to Crossroads. The North Village Rams will entertain Dandytown Hornets at Bernard Park. Elon and Elijah Daly both competed on day one of the 2017 Youth Swimming Cup in Canada, representing North York Aquatic Club. Elon Daly won the bronze medal competing in the girls' 12-year-old 800-meter freestyle, touching the wall in a time of 9:35.38. The boys' 11-year-old 1500-meter freestyle silver medal went to Elijah Daly, who was clocked at 18:54.65. The 65th Bermuda Goodwill Golf Tournament got underway yesterday, and the day proved to be a challenging windy day for the golfers. Day one saw play at Tucker's Point and Port Royal, with the highlight of the day being Kathy Carter of the Toronto Golf Club, who shot a hole-in-one on the number four at Tucker's Point. The longest drive at Port Royal was hit by Dwight Spence from Lakes Golf Club, while closest to the pin was Bob McBride from Wackerbach. The longest drive at Tucker's Point was hit by Bill Carr from Bedrock, while the latest longest drive was Valinda Velchik from South Fork. The men's closest to the pin was Todd Agner from Woodland Golf Club, and closest to the pin for the females was Katrin Burney from the Mid-Ocean Club. Dalray Rollins and his Sydney Cricket Club teammates went down by 7 wickets against St. George Cricket Club in their Kingsgrove Sports 2020 Cup match. St. George won the toss and sent Sydney to bat and restricted them to 157 for 6 in their 20 overs. Ryan Fletch was the top scorer with 55, while Rollins, for a second game in a row, could only manage 1 run. In reply, St. George would score 158 for 3 after 18.5 overs. Nicholas Stapleton was their top scorer with 56 not out, with Benjamin Magnetti, the pick of the Sydney bowlers, with figures of 2 overs, 1 for 8. Rollins bowled figures of 4 overs, none for 35. Bermuda School Archery League, run by David Seamus, has come to an end for Term 1, and we can now report the overall winners of the first term. Logan Every won the Under 12 Recurve Division with 671 points, while Alana Frith won the Over 12 Recurve Division with 801 points. Jaden Masters had 787 points and won the Under 12 Compound Division. Friesenbrook Maya Continental Bowling League action at the Warwick Lanes. It saw the Nifty Rollers defeat the Pin Jammers 24-6. New Hope defeated the Invaders 23-7, while Spice Knicks defeated the Bermuda Pest Control 24-6. The Cubs defeated the Oddballs 18-12, and Cricky Licky Laundry defeated the Underdogs 20-10.
Tonight's sports has been brought to you by the all-new Boundary at Fairmount Southampton, the West End's only sports bar. Catch all the action and enjoy smoked to perfection barbecue, beer, and other pub favorites. It's game on at Boundary.
I'm Earl Beasden with Bermuda Broadcasting Sports.
You can count on us.
Mixed peel and farine, just $3.99 per pound for your Christmas baking. Certified Angus beef, fresh top sirloin roast, only $8.99 per pound. Heinz crunchy and tangy piccalilli, just $2.99 for a 310-gram jar. Select varieties of stovetop stuffing, only $2.89 for a 6-ounce box. Select varieties of Sargento shredded cheese, just $4.29 for a 7-ounce package. All stores open Monday through Saturday until 10 p.m. and Sunday 9 a.m. to 7 p.m. for your shopping convenience.
You can count on us.
Peter Dorager basically said, you know, one part sailboat racing and 9 parts everything else. He was dead on.
All of us were sort of on eggshells going in saying, this is big, and are we going to be able to do this?
It's happening in Bermuda, which is a new location, a new dynamic, a different community, so many different aspects around it that you're almost slaying imaginary dragons.
And it's easy to be discouraged by the amount of work that you have to do in the time that you have.
I put myself out there personally, but I think Bermuda also, we put ourselves out there as a country.
Bermuda delivered on everything they said they'd do.
I think the America's Cup is an amazing spectacle and experience, but by the same token, it's really about those other 9 parts.
The Minister of Social Development and Sports, Zane De Silva, says the formula used by Grant Gibbons, the man who spearheaded Bermuda hosting the America's Cup, was outdated. Members of the House of Assembly debated the event on Friday.
When I started my speech, and we have the PLP, when we were in opposition, we did support the America's Cup, the initiative, and we certainly believe that it had benefits to Bermuda. You know, as I said on Friday, if you give me $100 million, I'll put some people to work and I'll get some tourists here. You know, when Grant Gibbons and the OBA talk about, you know, the long-term benefits and this legacy, the legacy benefits of the America's Cup remains to be seen. The issue that I had was the formula that Grant Gibbons used, which people in the industry worldwide are no longer using. So, you know, will we get $336 million benefit? I hope so, for the sake of Bermuda and Bermudians, as I said on Friday. So I continue to say that. I do hope we get benefit. We spent a lot of money. We spent almost 10% of our debt, $100 million, on this event. So when, you know, the OBA get up, and in particular Grant Gibbons gets up on Friday and is tooting his horn and talking about all the successes of the America's Cup, that's great. Give me $100 million and I'll show you some success too.
Yeah. I think you also had deep concerns about tender or lack thereof.
Well, and of course we know that that was the case. Grant Gibbons said in the House back in March that in 2015 that Berlin's had been given the management contract for the America's Cup and for all the works up there, and they would get 5% of the value. And the question was put then, and the question was put again Friday, was that was it put out to tender? And he said no, it wasn't, because they had to move very quickly. And of course that BC&M had given hundreds of hours of pro bono work. Well, if you gave me, if I knew that I could possibly get a contract that was worth several million dollars, I'll give you some pro bono work too.
So it sounds as if the debate is long from over?
Well, I don't know. The fact of the matter is we will only see the benefits, the long-term benefits of the America's Cup in the future. You know, I continue, and we continue, to have many concerns about the America's Cup and the amount of money that was spent. When you had buses, we had infrastructure issues, we have our senior issues, we have our civil servants who've worked for the last 6-7 years without any increase in wage whatsoever, but we found $100 million just like that.
Lastly, an unexpected find for staff at Pembroke Paint today. While unloading a shipping container, they came upon this stowaway, a raccoon. Inside, the animal wardens were contacted and arrived to take the animal away to have it humanely put down. Dr. Jonathan Nesbitt, the government veterinarian, telling us more than likely the animal may have been seeking warmth from the cold weather in North America and found its way into the container. And that's our newscast for tonight. I'm Diane Brewer. Thank you for joining us. Have a wonderful evening. Good night.